So these are mobile bits of DNA, if you like, DNA parasites related to viruses that jump around our genomes. Okay? The human genome is littered with dead transposable elements. On the order of a third or a half of all of your DNA is dead copies of this thing called the ALU element, first described by my friend and colleague Carl Schmidt in the chemistry department here at UC Davis. It's interesting, so if you think about mutation, often in terms of differences in base pairs, that some base pair goes wrong, an amino acid is substituted, or a codon, or a stop codon is inserted, and the gene is not transcribed correctly, or the product is not correct and does not function. Many mutations, including the mutation that started modern genetics. So they say genetics as a whole started with Mendel. Modern genetics started with Thomas Hunt Morgan and one very special mutation, the wild-eye mutation of Drosophila melanogaster. That mutation was also caused by a transposable element jumping into the white locus. So that's one interesting thing, the nature of mutations. The other, so a lot of interesting things in the Ellis et al. Article. Another is, what kinds of genes cause these phenotypic changes? Some of them are structural genes that contribute, that participate in biochemical pathways producing some effects. Others are what we think of as regulatory elements that tell genes when to turn off and on. So Professor Lott is an expert on the evolution of regulatory elements, and she'll lecture about that specifically. But I just want to warm you up, so I don't give you these readings are meant to be and should be instructive as to where we're going in the course. So I love to talk about history, but I also am a contemporary geneticist. Like every other contemporary geneticist, what I'm doing when I go back to my lab is looking at DNA sequences, doing comparative genomics, and all of that sort of stuff. The other thing that's extraordinarily interesting about that article is that why weren't they able to figure out all of them? So four of the seven have been pretty well sorted out, but three haven't been identified yet. Three of these characters, we don't know the precise gene that produced these alternative phenotypes. So this is this forward genetics idea. We have a phenotype, let's find the genetic change that's responsible for it. Why haven't those last three been sorted out? Well, it's sort of an odd thing to do. I mean, it's hardly anybody's research program to say, I'm gonna clone Mendel's genes. I mean, it was really cool to do the first couple, but the last three are sort of less cool. But also, the last ones, as always, are more difficult. They're more difficult. Why? Because there are alternative candidates. It's often true that if you have a clearly mutant phenotype, that for instance, if you're a human being who is only 3 feet 6 inches tall as an adult, there is something seriously wrong with your metabolism, right? You have some form of dwarfism. Well, I say some form of, because there are many loci that can be mutated that produce extraordinarily short height. In the same way, there are many mutations that can make plants extremely, extremely short. So it's cool that we have several of these nailed down. Maybe we'll never get all of them nailed down. Maybe we'll never get all of them nailed down because we can produce phenotypes that look like the ones Mendel described with mutations at different loci, or we know the locus and we don't know the nature of the specific allele that produced the mutation that Mendel studied. So all of Mendel's mutations are loss of function mutations. You can lose function in many different ways. You can insert a stop codon early on. You can screw up the area upstream of the gene where the transcription machinery sits down.
you know, put a transposable element in the middle, mess up a splice junction so an intron doesn't get pulled out, and you get an incorrect transcript and an incorrect protein. So the ones that we can figure out are specific. So the question is, so Mendel worked with these phenotypes. Do we know the genotypes that he was studying? Do we know the particular mutations? Well, only in those cases where there are historical records that he got the mutant plants, the variant plants, for a particular nursery, and people know, or people are fairly confident, what specific variety he was studying. So there are many obstacles to getting from here's what Mendel studied, and here is the specific genetic lesion that caused that mutation. Okay. So last time was all about Mendel number one, segregation. Segregation is absolutely central to the way genetic material is inherited. The alternative alleles go into gametes with probability a half, usually. And turns out that's not always true, and it's an interesting and deep question to understand why it's usually true and is it sometimes not true, and what's going on there anyway. I'll come back to that. We tend to think, when we're taught this stuff initially in high school, well, it's got to be 50-50, because that's the way chromosomes work. Well, they don't always work that way. The next thing we're going to talk about is Mendel's second law, so-called, independent assortment. And independent assortment isn't a law at all. So many genes are on separate chromosomes. It's being on separate chromosomes are very far apart on the same chromosome that leads to independent assortment, but that's not true of all genes. Okay? Organisms like the greatest organism, okay, we're going to review this, I mentioned it last time, what is the greatest organism?
Drosophila
specifically?
Melanogaster,
very good. Okay, this could be on the test. The queen of organisms has basically only three chromosomes. They have 15,000 genes, but basically only three chromosomes, right? A lot of characters are going to be linked. It turns out Pilum sativum has seven chromosomes. He studied seven characters, and most of them were on different chromosomes. There's an interesting ambiguity about that, in that we still don't know. We're fairly confident that some of them are linked, but we're not exactly sure whether the number of linked traits is one or two. And it might be zero, but that seems less plausible with increasing data. Again, why is that ambiguous? Because we haven't nailed down the specific locus, the specific place on a chromosome that corresponds to all the characters. And that's discussed in the Ellis et al. So I want to bring your attention to, if you pay attention to nothing in this article, just read, look at figure one and figure two. Okay? Talks about mapping the characters onto chromosomes with some ambiguity and talking about the nature of the mutations of the four that have been sorted out. So he looked at seven characters, and he talked about studying all seven as pairs. So inheritance. Pairs of characters, and let's do rounded versus wrinkled seeds, and yellow versus green. So in his first set of experiments,
he demonstrated that round was dominant, and there's a convention in elementary genetics and in the genetic literature to use a capital letter to denote a dominant allele. I will tell you, don't just think that that's a general rule. I will test, if there's dominance in a problem, I will tell you which allele is dominant. Versus little r. And just to review what we did last time, these two genotypes, I will denote capital R dash, corresponding to the round phenotype, versus little r, which is the recessive phenotype. And it's recessive as defined by the fact that you need two copies of the allele to produce the phenotype, as opposed to one sufficing. And that's a function of this being a loss of function. That a little bit of function gets you pretty round. You only need one dose of that allele. And I'll talk about the physiological basis of that. Another character is yellow versus green. And here, it's the yellow that's dominant. And there's a nice story here. That phenotype in modern genetic terms is called the stay green phenotype, and it's known to be associated with the lack of access to a degradation pathway for chlorophyll. So the gene that shunts the chlorophyll to be degraded is shut down, so the chlorophyll stays in the seed, making it green as opposed to yellow. So, what did he do? He had pure breeding. So experiment. Pure breeding. Round yellow crossed with pure. Wrinkled green, pure wrinkled green. And what he saw, and he saw this for, I mean, this is just like a weird thing. He saw it for all of his characters that the F1 looked exactly like one of the parents, The F1 was round yellow, and it was round yellow. He got the same result, again, from both reciprocal crosses, irrespective of whether you use the round yellow as a pollen parent or the seed parent. Okay. Now, this result that the F1 in a dihybrid cross resembles one of the parents is a complete artifact of his experimental design. Because the note, if he did not, but if he had used pure breeding, if he used pure breeding, round green, and he crossed that to a pure wrinkled yellow, what would he have got? He would have gotten exactly right. Round is dominant and yellow is dominant. He would have gotten an F1 that's round yellow. Okay? Because the the dominant phenotype shows. So the fact that the F1 looks like one of the parents when you're looking at more than one character, even with dominance, is an artifact. What? So F, then you got F1. So from now on, I'm going to do it in this conventional way, but realize that the phenotypic labels associated with this are sort of arbitrary. Sorry, they're not arbitrary. So round, this individual would have been round yellow. Round yellow, just like this guy here. Why? Because we can get there in two different ways. So, let me clarify this. So, Mendel. What Mendel actually did was to take that homozygote and cross it with that homozygote. And he got, well, the loci segregate independently. So we just do Mendel for one locus. We do the monohybrid cross for each locus separately. And it's heterozygous at both loci. And that phenotype is round yellow. But I say, alternatively, he could have done a round green with wrinkled yellow, pure green. And still, the F1 would have been the same. Right? So nothing matters from this point on. Once we have this genotype, it doesn't matter how we got it. The point being made is you can get that phenotype from parents with alternative phenotypes. And that's generally true when things are determined by more than one locus, that there'll be alternative ways to get there. So, then he crossed the, so these are our F1, and you could have gotten there this way or that way, but having gotten there, what he demonstrated was independent assortment. I.e., what independent assortment means is that each locus is inherited individually in the monohybrid crossway as a single Mendelian character and independently, i.e., the frequencies at each locus. Are independent. The frequencies at each locus are independent. Remember from your statistics class, if two events, A and B, are independent, so if A and B are independent, what we mean by that, flip it a coin, classic, flip it twice, probability of two heads, 1/2 times 1/2. That says probability A times probability B. this is the way you want to think about the inheritance of multiple unlinked loci in terms of probability theory and multiplying probabilities, as opposed to that stupid thing described in your textbook, the forked method, or thinking about coming up with a Punnett square for the gamete. You can think about the Punnett square. So to get the progeny, you got to think about the gametes produced by those F1 individuals. The same principle applies if they are unlinked. Or, gosh, I should be careful. If they independently assort, so what's the distinction? What's the distinction? The distinction is if things are, if we say they're unlinked, that means they exist on separate chromosomes. Okay? It's a fundamental property of meiosis that the parental chromosomes, the chromosomes of mom and dad, don't hang out together. They go independently to the poles. So if chromosome 1, paternal chromosome 1 goes north, there's no reason for paternal chromosome 2 to go north. It could equally likely go south. We'll get there. Okay. The distinction is, like in Drosophila melanogaster, basically only 3 chromosomes. If genes are way at the ends of chromosomes, if they're quite far separated from one another, they'll show independent assortment even though they're linked. So they're separate concepts. We'll talk about that in much more detail. So gametes, if independently assortment, if they're independently assorting, so we know at each for each one of these loci, at each locus, did Mendel number one, segregation. Half of the gametes carry one allele, half of the gametes carry the other allele, on average. Okay. I.e., one half capital R gametes, one half little r gametes. Similarly, at the yellow locus, half the gametes carry capital Y, half carry lowercase y. The question is, what does the gamete look like? What is the genetic constitution with respect to both loci? And the meaning of independent assortment is that we multiply probabilities. Probability capital R, capital Y, gamete. If I say those loci independently assort, what that means is to get the gamete frequencies, I just multiply the probabilities. Okay. What that means is that with respect to multiple loci, if they're independently assorting, I just think of the probabilities associated with one locus for each locus separately and multiply those probabilities. Okay. So let's do the classic 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. So at the F2, this is important. How do we derive that? Well, what we're doing is self-fertilizing double heterozygotes. And I say, with independent assortment, we get to think about each locus separately. So you can go through the tedious business of saying, well, one quarter of the gametes are capital R, capital Y, one quarter are capital R, little y, one quarter are little r, capital Y, and one quarter are little y. Right? There are four types of gametes, and they're going to put those four types of gametes together. So those can be produced by mom or dad. Okay? You don't want to do it this way. But you have to do it this way for problems where they're linked, but where they're... So, female gametes, male gametes, and we can go through. The four types of gametes, capital R, capital Y, capital R, capital, etc., each with probability a quarter, and we're going to get 1/16. And then we can look at that table and say, well, what's what? But why do that? And we can use our friend. So probability theory is your friend. You can always trust it. It will never let you down. So what's going to happen here? So at the R locus, okay, so you can think about this in an extremely boring way, or you can think about it in a much more elegant way. At the R locus, we're going to get, big surprise, you'll never guess what comes out, 1/4, 1/2, one quarter, otherwise known as R dash 3/4, 1/4, little r, little r. And at the yellow locus, and they're independent. These individuals are round, these individuals are wrinkled, these individuals are yellow seeds, these are green seeds. Okay? They are independent. So, implies that the probability of a green, yellow, F2 is those traits are inherited independently. That's the probability. Yes?
Green, yellow,
so shoot me. Sorry, thank you. Now, look, when I fucked, I said, this is the danger. Now you need power. I'm making this up as I go along up here. I will make mistakes. Please point them out. Round, yellow, thank you. Probability. What is the probability of green and yellow? Answer, not very big. It's probability round. Probability yellow. Okay? So probability R dash of the yellow dash is 3/4.
Wait, isn't that prettier than this? Isn't that prettier? See, the alternative is to go through all this crap. You know, fill out this table and realize that the ones with you just need one capital R, and so there's going to be little r, there's going to be little r, capital Y, little y. Anyway, you can also convince yourself that all of those individuals would be. I don't know. You can figure that out. I don't do it that way. I mean, it's possible to do this. But isn't this pretty? Isn't this pretty? So, and now you can do the rest of it that way. What is the probability? What's the probability of brown and wrinkled? So brown and green, again, probability brown, probability green equals, again, probability R dash, probability homozygote. So there are going to be four. So there are two alternative phenotypes there are two phenotypes with respect to each character. How many phenotypes in the F2? We'll put them together in all possible ways, 2 times 2. So there are 4 F2 phenotypes. When I use this terminology, I've jumped forward 36 years, right? Mendel, 1866, phenotype, that distinction was made by Manning Johansson for the first time. Actually, no, sorry, I've gone to 1908 to get to the phenotype-genotype distinction. For F2 phenotypes, and just putting all the possibilities together. So, you can be round and yellow, or you can be round and green, or wrinkled and yellow, green. And to get the probabilities, I just multiply the probabilities associated with each phenotype. So this is 3/4, 3/4, 3/4, 1/4, 1/4, 3/4. Put my colons in here. 1/4, 1/4. Otherwise known as 9/16, 3/16, 3/16, 1/16, or 9 to 3 to 3 to 1. The reason you want to think about it this way, rather than the stupid forked way, or go through the gametes, is that suppose I ask you about all 7 characters at once. Suppose I ask you, look, random. Suppose say I asked you on midterm 1, a random possibility.
asked you in midterm one, what happens? So now I'm going to talk about example. Many independently assorted loci. Random example. And I'll call them A versus little a, blah, blah, blah. So with the capital. Because you're going to think about trivial one locus Mendelian genetics. What is the problem? So you're going to say that this is the probability of the offspring being capital A, being capital B, little b, being capital C, capital C. Probability of capital D, little d, and you're just going to rattle them off. What is the probability of capital A, capital A?
A half,
right? Just the back cross. What is the probability of a heterozygous at the B locus? A half. What is the probability? This is really trivial. What's the probability of capital C, capital C?
Half.
And what is the probability of being a heterozygous? Trick question.
One.
Because it's a homozygote for the capital D here, homozygote for the little d here, so all of the progeny are heterozygotes. Okay? So the answer is one quarter cubed. And you know, I really do not give a shit as to whether or not you learned arithmetic in the fifth grade. So the answer like this is always the correct answer in the exam. I don't care about one half to the third is. Okay. So you can solve trivially using the principle of multiplying probabilities questions involving any number of Mendelian loci by just using simple Mendel 1 and multiplying the probabilities. Okay? Next, what else did the boy do for us? Well, Mendel then took each, so remember, this is what he sees. Mendel sees four phenotypes in the F2. He then did the Mendel thing. He crossed those, let those F2s first self-fertilize to produce an F3. And asked what F3 phenotypes were produced by the different F2 phenotypes. Okay? And the answer was that these guys fell into four classes. These fell into one. Classes in what sense? Some of these individuals, four classes, some produced four phenotypes. All four. Some of them produce these two, some of them produce these two. Yeah, and then, four phenotypes. Produce two. Others produce, let me go through it. This is sort of too abstract. And some fraction, Some fraction of these individuals, some were pure breeding. Now that's interesting. What's going on there? These these individuals, these round yellow individuals, so we'll explain the four classes within the four classes within the round yellow aptitude. What do I mean by the four classes? The four classes. Well, these round yellow F2 individuals all have a genotype that can be described as capital R dash, capital Y dash. In order to have that phenotype, you need one capital letter at each locus. Okay. So the four possibilities are the four ways you can fill in those two blanks. The four possibilities are that, that, why people use PowerPoint. It's hard to think on your feet. So those are the four possibilities. Okay? The four possibilities are homozygous at this locus, either homozygous or heterozygous, heterozygous at the R locus, either homozygous or heterozygous at the Y locus. And each one of these individuals, so these are the four possible F2, four genotypes that produce the same phenotype. Okay. Now, from each of these, you can get F3 by letting them self-fertilize. So again, a random question that might pop into my head, while I'm making up midterm one. A random question that might pop into my head is, what fraction of the round yellow F2, are pure breeding? How do you think about that? Now, since I'm a nice person, before I asked you this question, I probably would have warmed you up. I probably would have warmed you up by asking, what fraction of the F2, period, what fraction of the F2 are pure breeding? What fraction of the F2 are pure breeding? So, we know that this happens with frequency what?
1/16.
1/16. we know that this happens with probability 1/16. So this woman, brave woman, said obviously it's an eighth. Okay, true confession time, I'm an honest man. That's what I thought the answer was too, until she said it. Then as soon as she said it, I realized that's not right. Because these individuals will also be pure breeding. And these individuals will also be pure breeding. Okay, so it turned out, well, maybe I'm not a nice person. It's sort of a trick question. You have to think of, you have to think about it. So the real answer is 4/16. Because each one of those has probability 1/16. They're all pure breeding. Okay? A double homozygote will be pure breeding. Okay. But this is part of my the other question is part of my missionary effort to teach probability theory as part of genetics. Now, listen, what's the trick? What is with this old bastard that's making us do math in this genetics class? This is a fucking biology class. We do not do math in biology. That's why we became biologists, so we didn't have to do math. Why is this guy torturing us? What is his trick? And the answer is, and this is wonderful, I never knew that I could say this with confidence, but the answer is that modern genetics is increasingly mathematical. Everybody doing genetics does genomics. Like, not everybody, but essentially all people are doing genomic analysis. To do genomic analysis is to do bioinformatics, is to do mathematical analysis at one level or another. Okay, so math, which used to be the sort of weird thing that very few of us did in genetics, is now absolutely central to many genetics, well, to all genomic analyses. You can't analyze genomes without math. You can't make sense of all that data without some algorithmic structure. Yeah, and I am so old that now doing genomics is easy. It used to be hard, now it's quite simple. So, how are we going to answer this question? So first thing we're going to do is translate this into a probability statement. Probability, pure breeding, given brown, yellow, F2. So among the F2 that are brown and yellow, which ones are pure breeding? That is the probability, I'll just say pure for pure breeding, and brown, yellow. That's you have to have that genotype to have that phenotype, divided by, conditioned on, brown, yellow. So now it's trivial. Now it's trivial. Because among these individuals that carry one capital R and one capital Y, which genotypes are pure breeding? Only one. If you're a heterozygote, you're not going to be pure breeding. You're going to have segregation. So the only pure breeding individuals in this category, the only genotype that satisfies this criterion, pure breeding, and this criterion, carrying a capital R and a capital Y, is the double homozygote. Did I do it wrong?
No, I'm not going to check. So that even though if you have, so it's the F2s that we're assuming are, or that we're asking are pure breed. We're not at all considering at all F3s.
Well, she's asking, are we only considering F2 individuals? Answer, yes, I am asking about F2 individuals, but I'm asking, when I say pure breeding, what kind of F3 they will produce. So I'm asking which F2 individuals that have the phenotype round yellow will be pure breeding, will produce only offspring, F3 offspring that look exactly like themselves. The only ones are these. Okay? And this is trivial. So we do what comes naturally here. So independent assortment, that means we see a two locus statement, we make it into one locus statement and multiply the associated probabilities. Don't give me any hints. One quarter squared, three quarters squared, otherwise known as 1/9. Isn't that fun? Cheer up, kids. Probably don't have a brain tumor. I should have said that. I've said that forever. People used to call, when I was a kid, people would call my parents. I'd say, God, didn't you hear they were killed in a car wreck this weekend? I've always thought shit like that was funny. And I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and he was really serious. This guy's always ridiculously cheerful. And he looked quite serious. And he said, I have a brain tumor. And he did have a brain tumor, but he said, yeah, horrible thing. Yikes. I'll stop in your brain tumor jokes, I promise. Halftime. The only way you're going to produce four types of progeny is if you're doubly heterozygous. So this is just the probability of that. Which is a number. Okay. So that's how you do this. That's how you do these. Again, the alternative way to do it is to do the Punnett square, have the 4x4, 16 boxes, and count them. Okay? It's not going to be fun, especially if there are three love signs instead of two. Okay. Let's worry about, independent assortment, conditional probability, Many characters, now we're talking. Suppose Mendel looked at all seven at once. All seven characters at once. Yes. In this statement here?
Yeah.
No. I'm asking a question
about F2 individuals. I'm asking what fraction of the F2 that show a specific phenotype produce progeny, produce F3 of four different types. But I'm asking specifically about the F2 individuals. Okay? But you're right. I'm characterizing them with respect to their progeny, the F3 progeny that they produce.
So suppose Mendel looked at all seven at once. And let's say he looked at, he did the following cross, all dominant by all recessive. Okay. All together now, what does the F1 look like? By definition, all dominant. Okay? First question. Let's let these cross with one another. Let them self-fertilize to create F2. What fraction of the F2 have a parental phenotype? I should be a little bit more careful about the notation. All dominant, we'll call that parent one. All recessive, we'll call that parent two. What fraction of the F2 have a parental, i.e., P1 or P2 phenotype? How fun is that? The first thing you have to do is translate that English into genetics. Well, okay. Meaning, so what does that mean? That means I ask, what genotype will produce that phenotype, all dominant for all seven characters, versus this phenotype, recessive for all seven characters? What do you think? Yeah. Bingo. So, as this woman says, there are two possibilities. You have to think of them two ways. The P1 phenotype. How do you get to the P1 phenotype? With respect to each locus, so now there are seven of them. A dash. So I'm not going to come up with, I'll just use the first seven letters of the alphabet. I forget what the next four letters are. There are many letters in the alphabet, it turns out. Just write down the first seven letters of the alphabet. That gives you the P1 phenotype. The P2 phenotype only comes about in one way. So, the probability of an F2 with the P1 phenotype, what is that probability? It's not pi over 6. That is almost never the answer to this question. What do you think, kids? Talk to me. It's something to the seventh. To have the dominant phenotype, you have to be homozygote or heterozygote. That happens with probability 3/4. to the seventh. Three quarter to the seventh. Whereas the other one is which? One quarter. The other one is probability F2 with the P2 phenotype is one quarter to the seventh. Isn't that cute? Do that with a Punnett square. Okay? It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. See, whereas once you're used to thinking about this one locus at a time, I've asked you quite a trivial question, but you have to be able to translate it into the exploiting this property of independent assortment. Yeah?
If you have heterocyclers for 3-1, how would you get that?
Say it again?
If the P1 is heterocyclic dominant, how would you get an F1 all dominant?
Sorry. So these individuals were pure breeding. I should be clear that Mendel starts with pure. Mendel, for all of his experiments, started with pure breeding lines. So when I say it's all the dominant phenotype, the only way he got there is if it's homozygous at all those loci.
Yeah, but then the P1 should be.
Sorry, the P1 phenotype corresponds to having only one. You need at least one dominant allele at each locus. Okay? So that's the game. So the genotype that he started with was all the dominant alleles homozygous at each locus. In the F1, you're heterozygous at all of them, and hence you have the dominant phenotype for all of them. Now I ask you that seven locus heterozygote, what kind of progeny does it produce? Yes?
But in order to produce a P1 phenotype and our P1 is all dominant pure.
Yeah. No, sorry, the P1 is all dominant, but it's all heterozygote. Sorry, P1 is all dominant pure. Yes, sorry, it's yes. Genotypically, distinguishing genotype and phenotype, the P1 genotype is all homozygous for the dominant allele. You get the P1 phenotype if you have at least one dominant allele at each locus. Are you happy? How happy? You're really happy. Yes.
So just for clarification, the probability of the F generation, the probability that we are calculating on the board,
yes,
only refers to phenotype, not genotype.
I will tell you what it refers to. So here I've asked specifically a phenotypic question.
Okay.
I will be, I've been a professor for 40 years. 40 years, I think there's only one hard part of my job, only one, and that is coming up with good exams. Even after 40 years, I struggle to come up with good exams, meaning exams have to be, every question has to be absolutely unambiguous and fairly test you on the information I have provided to you, okay, at all level of ability. So the smartest of you can't be bored during the test, and those of you who have just worked really hard, there should be a bunch of questions that you just breeze through because I'm just asking you the stuff I've gone through in lecture. Yeah, so it will be unambiguous. I might not spend any time preparing my lectures, but I do spend a lot of time preparing my exams.
As far as answers that you would accept for this question, how is saying that you have a one-fourth and seventh probability that you have a P2 phenotype?
No, I do not give a shit about your ability to do arithmetic at any level. It just does not matter to me. Yes.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I would prefer that you write it that way, because that I know you've thought about it correctly. If you put some decimal, you won't have a calculator. So, I mean, you're going to spend a lot of time multiplying numbers. There's no calculator. Calculators are bad for you. How do I get the answer? How do I get the answer? I used a property of independent assortment. So what I want to know is, what is the probability that an F2 is A dash, B dash, C dash, D dash? Come on, I get tired. And the answer is, because I've told you, and I'm not going to make you guess, I told you that these loci are independently assorting, you instantly say, well, I solved independent assortment problems by multiplying probabilities. So, you've used genetics and what you understand about genetics to realize that the P1 phenotype is produced by many different genotypes. How many different genotypes? How many different genotypes produce that F1, that P1 phenotype? How many F2 genotypes produce the P1 phenotype? There are two genotypes with respect to each locus, so the answer is 2^7. Because you can be homozygous or heterozygous to each locus, and you multiply all those possibilities out. Yes?
In earlier problems, when doing probability, you were dividing by...
Those are conditional probabilities.
Okay, can you explain
yes? When I ask, among this group, what fraction satisfies that? So probability of being bigger, taller than 6 feet, conditioned on being female versus conditioned on being male. So it should be clear that it's conditional on. So what fraction of this group? So I could ask among. Okay, you asked for it. What fraction of the F2 individuals with the P1 phenotype are pure breeding for the P1 phenotype? Okay? If I asked you that question, I could ask you, just to illustrate how conditioning is different. You gotta know I'm bullshit. I do spend a couple hours reading over my notes, but I spend much more than a couple hours coming up with the thing. So I can ask, what fraction? With P1 phenotype, are pure breed. I don't think I've ever asked a question this hard in anything. But this would make you a better person. I would be doing it only for your own good. Probability, F2, that are P1 pheno and all F3 P1 pheno, given that there are P1 pheno
in F2? What fraction of the F2 that produced P1 phenotype are pure breeding for that? And that would be, what is the probability of being a homozygote at all of those loci, conditioned on being at least having one copy? Okay. There would be, in that case, 1/4 to the 7th divided by 3/4 to the 7th. Okay, so. Yes?
So, you know how you just asked how many genotypes can get you the one with the answers to the 7?
Yes.
How would you do that as a notation? Like P to the probability of 1?
Oh, when I ask a number of possibilities, that's a simple combinatorics. This is the sort of stuff that Mendel got off on. So, if I have people with, 12 kinds of hairstyles in the room and 4 kinds of jackets, I can ask how many possible combinations of jackets and hairstyles there are, and I multiply the number of jackets by number of hairstyles. Where are we, kids? Let's do repeated selfing. I might let you read about. We have to do goodness of fit. We have to do goodness of fit. So this is the first formal statistical test, the chi-square test. The paper has such a great name. This paper has such a great name. This is Carl Pearson from 1900. Sentences long. It'll be in the notes. Sorry, I don't remember. Okay, let me do chi-square. I don't want to do all math. Let me do some biology. Mendel wrote a famous paper. He wrote another paper that's not famous. Mendel, 1870, on these things called hawkweeds, Heraclium. I don't know. Anyway, he did it. He wrote a second. So Mendel tried to. I like all people, of course. Well, I like all people. He wants to get acknowledgement from his peers. So he writes to the most famous botanist, this guy Notley, asking him, "Well, what do you think of my work?" And the guy said, "I'm not so sure. I mean, those weird characters. I've done a lot of hybridizations in my life. I haven't seen that. Why don't you try to repeat your result with other organisms? I know, why don't you use my favorite organism, these hawkweeds?" Okay? Turns out, this was really fucking bad news. Hawkweeds, when you hybridize them, the hybrids reproduce asexually. They reproduce parthenogenetically. Okay? Only mitosis, no meiosis. So Mendel writes the second paper where he looks at these other, remember his paper is on plant experiments on plant hybrids. He just looked at these hybrids and peas, got these pretty results. He didn't get those pretty results when he did flowering time. And he didn't get the pretty results when he looked at flower color in another species, Phaseolus, the common bean, Phaseolus vulgaris. For seed color in Phaseolus, he got intermediate F1s and the F2s were sort of odd. They certainly were nothing like 1/4, 1/2, 1/4. The theme being that most characters aren't governed by single Mendelian loci, but things really went bad when he looked at these hawkweeds. He looked at the F1s, then when he let the F1s fertilize,
He thought, self-fertilized, what they were doing was propagating parthenogenetically through mitosis, without any meiosis. All the progeny looked exactly like the F1s. He didn't see any evidence for segregation because no segregation was going on. Okay? So Mendel ended his life really having no idea he made a fundamental discovery, because it did not generalize in any simple way to other plants and to other characters. We now know he did make a fundamental discovery about how the alleles at individual loci and the alleles at loci on separate chromosomes are inherited, but that does not correspond in general to how phenotypes are inherited. Okay. I did this. To understand whether Mendel cheated, we have to know how one tests data fitting a hypothesis. So this is Carl Pearson. Who came up with the chi-square test. So what is it? The idea is you do an experiment with n possible outcomes. N possible outcomes. Okay, one. Constructed a hypothesis about what the probability is for each outcome. Let Pi equal the predicted probability of outcome I. So Mendel, when he does a test cross, for each locus, he predicts 50-50 of the two phenotypes. What you do is see experiment. Yeah, let me change this. Sorry, this did not confuse you. Let me make this K possible outcomes. K possible outcomes. Perform the experiment N times. Perform the experiment means, in the context of Mendel, you look at n offspring. You look at 406 offspring. So you observe OI outcomes of type I. You want to compare that to
two. The expected number of outcomes of time R. So all of this is in those two handouts. I gave you a handout called Mendel's P's on probability theory, then I gave you a handout at which at no additional charge derives the chi-square distribution for you, just because I'm a nice person. And the question is, do those observations fit the expectation? So, OI is observed, EI is the expected number. Now, if I tell you that the probability that any one of my experiments produces outcome I is PI, and I perform the experiment capital N times, how many times do I expect outcome I? What is my expectation? The context you know. I flip a coin 50 times. I tell you it's a fair coin. How many heads do you expect? 25. Probability times the number. So EI, the expected, is the number of trials, number of offspring we score, times the probability, the Mendelian expectation, that it should have some frequency. Okay. It's a ridiculously beautiful paper and very difficult mathematically, that Pearson showed. Pearson showed that if you form the test statistic x squared as summation I equal 1 to k, OI minus EI squared, the square deviation of the observed from the expected over the expected. This follows a chi-square distribution with k minus 1 degrees of freedom. With k minus 1 degrees of freedom. If PI are the correct probabilities. So I've thought about some problem. I think I understand what's going on biologically. Segregation, independent assortment. My biological understanding tells me that of the F2 in a two-factor cross, 9/16 should be doubly dominant. 1/16 should be doubly recessive. Okay? The PI comes out of having this hypothesis based on my experiments. I'm Mendel. I can come up with these predictions. Okay? It's critical to understand. Pearson, 1900, Mendel, 1866. When Mendel did his experiments, there were no statistical tests. There was no idea of a statistical test. Back then, it was like pornography. You knew it when you saw it. The data looked like they fit my hypothesis. Okay? It was just, looks good to me, doesn't look good to me. Okay? The first person to say, I can probabilistically evaluate how well data fits a hypothesis is Carl Pearson. And he did it specifically to understand heredity. What does this mean? What does this crap mean? I will go through an example. But We do an experiment, we get the observation, we get the expectation, we form this test statistic, we get a number, we get a number. We look, that number under the null hypothesis follows a particular statistical distribution, a chi-square distribution, whose degrees of freedom depend on the possible number of outcomes. So there are only two possible outcomes. It's a chi-square with one degree of freedom. Okay? What is a chi-square with one degree of freedom? Answer, you take a normal 0, 1 random variable, and you square it. Okay? Normal distribution, mean 0, variance 1. Take an observation, square that, and make a histogram distribution, and you ask, is that number likely to follow that distribution? Answer, is the probability bigger, so conventional usage, is the probability bigger than 0.05 that observation could have followed a chi-square distribution? Okay. That's the game. Let's do an example. And these statistical tests are critical to evaluating the hypothesis that Mendel falsified his data. Okay? It was claimed in a very famous paper by R.A. Fisher, the inventor of modern statistics, a descendant of Pearson, that Fisher must have fudged his data because it fit too well. The chi-square values are too small. So let me get to the punchline of that. That's bullshit. I can't believe that Fisher made this mistake. Because if you read Mendel, Mendel tells you, and I made it bright yellow in the copy of Mendel I gave you. Mendel tells you, remember, when Mendel did this, there is no statistics. What did Mendel do? He looked at the data, and the data either looked pretty good or they didn't look pretty good. What did Mendel do if the data did not look good? He tells you, he collected more data. He said, I have a prediction. I want to see 3-to-1 in this cross. If he did the cross, it looked like 2-to-1. He said, not good. I don't like this. I want to see 3-to-1. What he did was, he did that cross again and collected more individuals. And what he found every time he did this was that the data came closer to his expectation. That game is only going to work if your hypothesis is true, right? If you have a hypothesis and you collect some data and it doesn't look good, if your hypothesis is wrong, you collect more data, it's going to get even worse. You're going to So Mendel didn't have the chi-square, and this claim that he fudged his data because the fit was too good is crap. And, you know, it's just bad reading by Fisher. Let's do an example of chi-square, and then I'll show you a more subtle problem with Mendel. And what is remarkable is if you look at the data in Mendel's paper, every experiment he did fits his expectation. If you do the chi-square test, the outcome always has probability bigger than 0.05. Even I don't remember Mendel's data. Yeah. Okay. So this is from page 411 of Mendel. Page 411 of the copy of Mendel, the translation of Mendel that I gave you. He looked at 519 F2 plants. 166. F2 plants with the dominant phenotype. F2 plants with the dominant phenotype. 166 with pure breeding. So remember, we predict 1/3 will be pure breeding. So remember, this is the game. Okay. So here's our F2. One quarter. These are the dominant phenotype. Of them, 1/4/3, otherwise known as 1/3, are expected to be pure breeding. Okay. So all you have to do is keep track of two numbers here. N. P1, the probability of being pure breeding is 1/3. P2, 2/3, not pure. So, in this case, k equals 2, and the number of observations is 519. O1 is 166. Okay. So O2, don't give me any hints, is 519 versus 166. What happened here? Is this time up? Fuck me, I'm sorry. So E1 is 519 times 1/3. That's a number, it turns out. And this form the chi-square statistic, and do what comes naturally, then look it up in the chi-square of 1 degree of freedom. So take it from there.